Okay, so I'm in Lesotho, and this is my 73rd country that I'm going to eat cornflakes in. These ones are rather cool, actually. They're called Jiggy's cornflakes, and there's a little symbol of an elephant, which I quite like. Now, we've chosen to do it in a spot which is very sacred to the Bazutu people, and the Bazutu people are—they're a huge tribe, and they spread into South Africa and other countries around Southern Africa. But this country is basically the vast majority of Lesotho is Bazutu people. Behind me here is a very significant symbol. This is found on their birth certificates, their driving licenses. It's a very symbolic symbol for the Bazutu people and for Lesotho, the country. I can't open the fucking thing. Yeah. And this is where the Bazutu people or the Bazutu nation was founded. It was in the 1800s, I think it's 1824, when the king Moshushu basically had to hide away from clans and tribes who were not doing very nice things in the area around here. And he got together different tribes and formed the nation on top of this hill. Now, there's all sorts of fascinating stories attached to it to do with how they came at night so that they could block off all the entrances so that no people could get up here. They didn't want anyone to bring any weapons with them, so we've had to bring a stone with us because stones were their main weapon at the time. And we've brought stones with us and placed them there and sort of said, sort of, you know, there's our weapons and we come in peace kind of thing. Some of their homes over here are... there's stone houses, and they were taught how to build these houses by a couple of Irish guys who weren't really interested in the wars that were going on between the white people at the time. Much like us, really, not interested in all this war nonsense, to be honest with you. So here we go. Here's my 73rd country. Not bad, but...
When looking on a map, you'd be forgiven for thinking Lesotho was a province of South Africa. But the Bazutu people are very proud of their independence after a hard struggle to prevent being absorbed by the country that surrounds them. Being a microstate on the other side of the globe, I'd never even heard of Lesotho before I travelled there, even though it was a British colony until 1966. Out of all the microstates I visited, this was the one that felt most like a country to me. And unlike most others, Lesotho has a proper border, and once you've crossed, you notice a significant drop in the standard of living compared to South Africa. There also seemed to be a much larger percentage of people living in rural accommodation, with people wearing less Western attire, choosing instead the traditional Lesotho blankets, sometimes accompanied by their infamous hats. Like a lot of microstates, there wasn't much to do for foreign visitors. From the sacred hill where the nation was established, we travelled to a neighbouring valley to visit another of the country's major tourist attractions in some hidden caves, which have been inhabited since the early 1800s by another group of people who were also trying to hide from cannibals. It was a major tourist attraction, but there wasn't really much to see, and we soon realised the same about the country. With such a young history and about 40% of the population living on less than a euro a day, there wasn't much to do on a quick 3-day visit, as time is needed to be able to really experience what Lesotho has to offer. Known as the Kingdom in the Sky, it is the only country in the world that lies entirely above 1,000 metres, with more than 80% above 1,800 metres. So we headed into the mountains, very slowly, climbing one of the steepest roads I've ever seen, in our car that seemed like it should run on batteries. But with beautiful mountain scenery and traditional huts everywhere, we weren't exactly in a hurry anyway. In Simong Kong, we went to the town lodge and arranged to do the longest single drop abseil in the world, which you do next to the 204-metre Maletsunyane waterfall. In the afternoon, we walked through some more amazing scenery to take a look at the fall and see what we had signed ourselves up for. Right hand. Start right from you. We decided to take a break from sleeping in the car when we found out the dormitories in the hostel had open fires in them. In the morning we had a quick half an hour training session, then went straight to the top of the falls to earn our Guinness World Record certificates and fill our pants with another guy from Holland who had also signed up.
So how are you feeling? How am I feeling? I'm not even thinking about it, and I think that's the best way to do it, actually. Yeah. I think too much, I'll probably shit myself. And I also haven't seen over the edge yet, which makes a big difference.
Yeah.
How are you feeling?
Shitting myself. And you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Who's going first?
Our new friend wanted to get it over and done with, so went first. And Rich, being scared of heights, wanted to go last. So it wasn't long before I was suddenly holding onto a bit of rope, being told to walk backwards off the edge of a massive cliff. And despite all the safety measures, it wasn't easy. I didn't take much time to take in the scenery. My survival instincts made me pull my finger out. I really picked up the pace when I started getting wet as the river water was freezing due to the altitude, but it still took me just over 15 minutes to reach the bottom. Next up was Rich. We then walked out of the canyon, reflecting on an incredible experience that left us happy to have done it, but also glad it was over. We drove out of the mountains and back into South Africa to continue on the road for another 3 months, exploring some of the best spots of Botswana, Namibia, Swaziland, and South Africa. I want you by my side, so that I'm
carrying them down, one handed.
We don't talk about it, dance them on, do the boogie all night long.